The Ring is a horror mystery novel that would change the world and Koji Suzuki's life forever. Suzuki, known as the Stephen King of Japan, skyrocketed to fame when his novel The Ring was published in 1991. The story follows an investigative journalist who's seeking answers behind a mysterious videotape that curses anyone who watches it to die 7 days later. The novel, which Suzuki wrote during his time as a stay-at-home dad, would go on to sell 500,000 copies by 1998, and 1.5 million copies by 2002. The success spawned multiple books in the series, including Spiral and Loop, as well as multiple films, including the American remake in 2002. Credited as one of the creators of the J-horror surge, Suzuki wasn't actually a fan of horror at the time. He told the New York Times in a 2004 interview, "I actually don't like all that supernatural stuff. I really dislike most horror writing." After the massive success of The Ring, the author even vowed never to write horror again. However, he broke his vow when he went on to write The Edge in 2012. In 1998, the book was adapted into the film Ring, also known as Ringu, directed by Hideo Nakata, who, like Suzuki, wasn't a fan of horror at the time. Telling The Hollywood Reporter, he became a horror director by accident. Similarly to the book, the film was a massive success in Japan, earning over $19 million at the box office, popularizing J-horror internationally and paving the way for films like Ju-on: The Grudge. Similar to the virus spread through Sadako's videotape, The Ring would grow into a massive franchise. It received an American adaptation in 2002, which would also become a massive success. Directed by Gore Verbinski, who is known for going on to direct Pirates of the Caribbean, and starring a then unknown Naomi Watts, The Ring would gross over $249 million worldwide, becoming one of the highest grossing horror remakes of all time. The film's success was credited in large part to its PG-13 rating and the success of its viral marketing campaigns and ads that displayed a ring with the tagline, "Before you die, you see the ring." The first book in the series follows a man named Asakawa who is pulled into a mystery surrounding four teens who all died on the same day. Asaka soon learns that the teens all watched the same videotape, and soon he watches the tape himself. Unfortunately, watching the videotape gets you killed, and now Asaka has 7 days to learn how to stop the curse before it kills him. So I read The Ring in about a week, which was fitting for the time frame of the curse, how long it takes to kill you. And overall, I really enjoyed it, but I do think that the films were a little better. They were a little better. So I'm gonna go into a little bit more spoiler territory of the book and the film from here on out. So if you don't wanna be spoiled, I would suggest leaving. The book has a similar storyline that is seen in the film, but they also vary a lot. There are several plot points in this book that are not in the movie. This book is great at setting up that feeling of dread. It's filled with apprehension, and I wanted to keep turning every page to find out what was gonna happen. No one felt safe. We know that the teens in the book all die of a mysterious instance right off the first pages, but we don't know that it's a videotape until several pages later. Unlike the films that actually explain the curse immediately, we open up with two teenage girls sitting on the bed, and they're basically rehashing the urban legend of this cursed videotape that if you watch it, you receive a call that you're gonna die 7 days later. And I think that's one of the better changes that they made for the film, because it really sets the tone for the rest of the movie. It sets up the inciting incident immediately, so we know what we're dealing with. And the book, it's a little bit more mysterious. Unfortunately for me, I found the characters in this book to be extremely unlikable in comparison to the film. So the main difference in this book is that the main character is a male, and in the films, it's a female. It's a single mom. The male character, he's married with a wife, and he's just very kind of comes off very selfish and immature to me. He acts very shitty towards his wife. He's very harsh towards her, and it's almost like he's annoyed by her, like she's just there to exist. And I guess he's just as neglectful as the protagonist is to her son in the movie. He's like that towards his family. And his best friend, Yuji, that he pulls into the case, it's revealed that he is a rapist and that he sexually assaulted a college girl when they were younger, and he told Asakawa about this, and he's kept his secret ever since. This reveal just immediately made me not like this character and not trust him, and I don't understand the point of making the character be this way because it doesn't really factor into the story at all. It just feels completely out of place. So that was one huge issue I had. I also had an issue with Asakawa in the book doesn't really have a strong connection to Sadako / Samara as the protagonist seems to in the movie. In the movie, there's that sort of motherly connection between the main female protagonist and Sadako / Samara. Yes, they care about finding the end of this curse and stopping it, but they also seem interested in finding out what happened to this poor girl, what happened to her, and laying her to rest. And I didn't get that same vibe when I was reading the book. There just didn't seem like there was any depth to his character like I found with the characters in the film. Along with Yuji's backstory that I found completely unnecessary, there are other instances of plot points that were introduced to this book that I completely do not understand. I do not understand their need. And one of them is Sadako. She has both male and female genitalia, and I think they call it some type of syndrome. They refer to it as a condition. And it just felt like a random revelation that she had this condition, and I just didn't understand the point, and I don't know what it had to do with the overall story. In the book, Sadako, she's so alluring to men, and this one man, he assaults her, and that's how he learns that she has male and female sexual organs, and it like enrages him, and in order to avoid being caught for what he did, he kills her and throws her in the well. So her death in the book is completely different than her death in the films. I felt like the sexual assault angle in the book, it just, the way it was portrayed and the way rape is discussed in this book, it's almost like it's not a big deal, when in actuality that's a serious thing. And they even accuse or insinuate that Sadako, she wanted to be raped because she didn't want to die a virgin. And I just, that's such a man thing to think. That whole thing, I was very turned off from that. And those were the biggest problems I had with this book, is the way they deal with rape. Another thing that I thought was interesting but weird was that Sadako in the book, she joins an acting troupe, and everybody there like describes her as eerie, and there's a man there who's like, he's basically obsessed with her, and he wants to, I don't know what he wants to do, but it doesn't sound like it's good. But he says he's gonna go like break into her house basically, and then the next day he drops down dead. So I think that was highlighting the fact of her powers, but it was just so weird that she had to go join an acting troupe. It felt so out of place to me, and none of that is in the film. So in the film, she's murdered by her parent. In the original film, she's murdered by her father, and then in the American remake, she's murdered by her mother, and she is murdered because of her special powers. Like, she's so powerful that they want to just get rid of her. I didn't like those certain elements in the book, but where the book is successful is in its atmosphere. It does a perfect job at creating this very mood, dark atmosphere, and the environment is very unsettling, and I just was worried for the characters a lot. I didn't know where they were gonna go. I didn't know who else was gonna get pulled into this curse, and it was just a fun experience. It moves a little slowly in the beginning, but then once it picks up to the mystery, it starts moving quickly, and you're just following these two characters on their investigation, which is my favorite part. I love them researching and learning the backstory of Samara. In the book, I found Sadako's backstory to be really interesting. Her mother was also a psychic, or had psychic abilities, because she got this very powerful stone out of the ocean, and it gave her psychic powers, and then it somehow translated to Sadako, and her mother would predict things, and then pretty soon she was basically made to be a laughingstock from the community, and she threw herself into a volcano, which she predicted would erupt, and it did. And I guess the way that Sadako's mother was treated by society, like, that anger just brewed within her over the years, and they also treated her similarly because they learned she also had those powers, and she was just always looked at as being weird and airy. So I think that all of that accumulated into this rage that she pushed out with the videotape. There's a lot of complex ideas in the Ring book, and I think they're interesting, and I think at times it got a little convoluted for me. I think the author has some really interesting ideas that he must probably explore in the additional entries in the series, but I haven't read those yet, so I don't know how they compare. Sometimes it felt like there was a lot of exposition with the story because they have the disadvantage of not being able to show us the psychic flashbacks or images like they do in the film. Overall, I really enjoyed this book despite my issues with it, but I do think that the films, they improved a lot on the source material, they made it more engaging, and they removed subplots that were unnecessary. The big changes in the films are that the film protagonist is female in both the original Ring film and the American remake. And she's a single mom, which was another element that I enjoyed. I think it made her more real and more appealing to me. It was just a more interesting story for me than the Asakawa, who was just like this married bachelor who just kind of was just very boring to me. I don't know how to describe my feelings. He just didn't do it for me. I feel like I was able to connect more with the female protagonist, and obviously it's because I'm female. I can connect with her more, but also I just felt like she was more of an empathetic character. I also think there was a big theme of motherhood in both films, because Rachel in the Ring remake and Asakawa in the original, they're both career-driven mothers who are shown as kind of neglectful to their sons because they choose to work instead of do motherly things. And however, despite not being the perfect mother, they still care so deeply for their child that they're willing to do whatever it takes to save him. And that includes sacrificing themselves. So I thought that was an interesting exploration of that. And in my research, I saw that in the book of essays, Planks of Reason, writer Ruth Goldberg says that the Ring expresses ambivalence to motherhood. Our main character, she's a mother who neglects her natural role, and she has all these fears and worries that manifest in this curse, the supernatural. And I thought that was a really interesting way of looking at it, and I think there's a lot of truth to that. Another huge change in the films from the book is that Yuji, the person who aids our main character, was switched to be a love interest rather than just a best friend. And I really liked that change. In the Ring, the original film, Yuji is Asakawa's ex-husband, and he actually has ESP, psychic abilities, like Sadako, and his son also does too. So there's like that deeper connection he has to the case. And he's very level-headed and calm, and he's a professor, so he thinks in a different way than Asakawa does. So I love the balance that they have with each other. And in the American remake, Rachel turns to Noah, her ex-boyfriend and father of her child, and he's actually a photographer who analyzes media. So it makes sense why she would pull him into this situation where he can help analyze these photographs that she's taking with the blurring face effects and just analyze the videotape. Like, it makes sense. My battery died, so if you notice any changes, that's why. So the overall plot line of the cursed videotape, that is pretty much the same, but there are also major changes to the mystery within the American remake. In the American remake, the tape revolves around a horse breeder named Anna, who she commits suicide by throwing herself off a cliff after her horses drown themselves. And she has a daughter named Samara, who she adopted, and this Samara has weird psychic abilities, and then she murders her. Another huge difference is that Sadako in the book is a grown woman, and in the American remake, she's a child. I like in the American remake how that Rachel spends a little bit more time on the island where Samara's from, and I just love that moody atmosphere, that cold, wet, dark setting of the American remake. And I think I love the American remake the most because I think they just elevated the story more and they put their own spin on it, and I think that there were a lot more interesting, creepy moments in the remake that are missing from the original. The original is that slow dread buildup with the mystery revolving around it, and the remake is too, but the remake also adds sprinkles in some scares, like the scene where Naomi Watts pulls the long hair out of her throat. Like, that's disgusting. Like, moments that make you just like want to cringe and crawl in your skin crawl. And they also, the special effects of what happens to the people when they see Samara is just terrifying. In the book, the ending is kind of anticlimactic for me. There is no Sadako or some Sadako crawling out of the TV to kill Yuji. He just sees like his reflection, and his reflection is growing old, and he kind of dies off screen. In the movies, they have her coming out of the TV, and I remember seeing the American remake when I was a teenager, and when she comes out of the TV, I was so freaking scared. I just remember when they show her face for that first time, I couldn't sleep. I remember that giving me nightmares. My brother likes to say I slept in my parents' room for a while, but that's not true, I don't think. But I mean, there's no shame in that, because that shit was scary. So I think that it's a very interesting story, and I think that it's funny that the film has spawned multiple adaptations. It's been made into a video game, a manga, multiple films that I haven't seen. Like, there are so many films in this franchise that I didn't even realize. So it's like spreading like the virus in the story. It's funny that even 30 years later, it's still going. And I think that it's a horrifying idea. I love the idea of an urban legend that has come to life, and there's really, you know, there's no way you can really stop it. You just have to keep continuing on the curse, and I think that's terrifying. I just really enjoyed the book, but I liked the movie better. I highly recommend the book. I think it is definitely worth a read. I think I rated this 3 out of 5 stars, but again, I feel like it's difficult. Japanese isn't my first language. I'm reading a translated version. I feel like sometimes there's things that can be lost in translation, and I also really want to read the follow-up stories, the sequel and the third book in the series, to see where it goes. My AC is making noises. It just scared the shit out of me because I'm thinking about Samara. Let me know if you've read The Ring or if you plan on reading it, and how you compare them to the movies. I think it's really interesting because the movies differ a lot, especially the American remake. And let me know if you've read any of the other books in the series, because I would love to know your thoughts and know if they're worth reading. And yeah, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed my analysis of the book and the film. I'm planning to do more videos like this on books to movie adaptations, because there's a lot, and I have a lot, and I've been slowly building up my collection. I have a fascination with Donald Sutherland book to movie adaptations, but books that were adapted into movies starring Donald Sutherland. So that's coming soon. It might not be that specific, but thanks so much for watching, guys. I'll catch you next time. Bye.